Alright guys, so now we're pretty much pros at the SN2 mechanism. But it turns out that not all substitution reactions proceed through the SN2. There's actually another mechanism out there that also produces substitution at the end. And that mechanism is called SN1. Alright, so if I were to just generally paraphrase what SN1 is, I would say the following sentence. Okay, and what you're going to notice is that quite a few of the keywords that we use for SN2 are going to change. So what it is that a neutral nucleophile, so that's a big deal, neutral, is going to react with an inaccessible leaving group. Okay, so what am I talking about here? Well, neutral means that, remember that SN2 is negative. So this one means neutral, it's not going to have that strong nucleophilic property, okay? Inaccessible has to do with R groups. So we're going to get there to in a second, but you can already start to think that must mean that there's a lot of R groups maybe, okay? And that's going to produce substitution in two steps. So what you can see is that in this sentence, almost every word has changed except for substitution. What that means is at the end, I still get a very similar product, which is a substitution product, but all of the conditions have pretty much changed. Now, instead of being negative, it's neutral. Instead of being accessible, it's inaccessible. And instead of happening in one step, it's going to happen in two. So let's just go ahead and start breaking this mechanism down. Okay, the biggest thing that you're going to notice that's different about the SN2 versus the SN1 is that my nucleophile looks totally different. Before, my nucleophile was the initiator in the reaction. My nucleophile was like the arrow. It had a very strong negative charge and it was looking for any backside to react with. Okay, if I draw that same first step here, that's a huge mistake. Do you know why? Because this is not negatively charged, so it's not very nucleophilic. It's not looking for a backside right now. In fact, it's happy. It's neutral. So the nucleophile is just chilling. All right? So to just draw it going to the backside would be a huge mistake. That nucleophile is chilling. It doesn't need to do anything. It's neutral. So that means that the first step must be something else. And it turns out that the first step is going to be very unusual. And I know that it's going to be weird, so I'm just going to try to get it over with. It's that the X, or the halogen, the leaving group, is going to take off all on its own. All right? So now this is weird because ever since I've been teaching you about mechanisms, I've always said that you make a bond first, and then after, you break a bond. But here, what I'm doing is I'm breaking a bond without making one first. I'm just breaking it by itself. All right? Why is that possible? How does this even make sense? Well, unfortunately, I don't have another reaction in organic chemistry that I can compare this to. We've never done this before. But if you think way back, when you took Gen Chem 2, we actually do know a reaction that was similar to this. I'll try to make the explanation quick because I know you barely remember Gen Chem 2 probably. But remember when we were thinking back on acids and bases and we learned about titrations and we talked about how pH had to do with the amount of hydrogen ions you had and the OH ions. Well, what we learned is that the Kw of water, the dissociation constant of water, was 1 times 10 to the negative, you guys remember? It's been such a long time, right? Negative 14. What the hell does that mean? Okay? What it means is that water is normally H2O, right? And that's the way it's happy. But for some random reason, one out of every 100 billion molecules is going to decide to just split apart on its own and make H plus and OH minus. Okay? For a split second, it's going to do that. And guess what's going to happen? It's going to hate its life because now it's two ions and it's way less stable, and then it's going to come back together, all right? This is a random process that's happening all the time, okay? You can almost think of it like a divorce, but then they get right back together because they realize that they actually like each other, okay? So in the same way, alkyl halides have a dissociation constant as well. So I'm going to put here KRX. But that dissociation constant is actually going to be a lot higher. Why? Because water is very unstable after it dissociates, okay? But alkyl halides actually already have a really strong dipole. Not on top of that, the bond, the carbon-halogen bond, is actually a very, very weak bond in comparison to the water. So what that means is that it's actually going to be easier for the alkyl halide to dissociate than water will be. So I don't know the exact number. I'm just going to make one up. Let's say that instead it's 10 to the negative 7, okay? Now remember that this is on a exponential scale, so that doesn't mean it's twice as good. That means it's like a million times as good, all right? And all I'm trying to say is that this is gonna wind up giving me ions as well, but at a better rate than I would usually get for, or a better equilibrium than I would usually get for water, okay? So what that means is I'm gonna wind up getting C positive, and I'm gonna wind up getting X negative, all right? And that's what's happening here. All I'm trying to say is that random processes are going to drive my alkyl halide to ionize, and that's always gonna be the first step. So what that means is that my nucleophile is chilling, it's neutral, but now, for some reason, my alkyl halide is gonna ionize by itself, all right? And what that's gonna give me is a positive charge and a negative charge. The positive charge is what we're gonna call our carbocation, okay? Now what our carbocation is gonna look like is it's gonna be this carbon right there, okay, so I'm just gonna draw that carbon, but now it's only attached to three things. It's attached to an H, it's attached to an ethyl group on one side, and it's attached to a methyl group on the other, okay? Now, this carbon wants to have four bonds, but it only has three, so it needs a positive charge, okay? Now, do you guys remember what the hybridization and geometry was of a carbocation? Three bonds. It should be, I'm just gonna write here, it should be sp2, okay? Because it only has three groups, or three bond sites, and it should be trigonal planar. I'm gonna put TP, but that's just gonna mean planar, trigonal planar. So notice that before I had my methyl on a wedge and my hydrogen on a dash. You can't draw it that way anymore because trigonal planar means that it's all on the same plane, okay? So it's actually wrong to draw it that way. Now we have to draw everything with a stick on the plane. Is that cool so far? This is what's called our carbocation intermediate. Okay, and this brings us to the possibility or to the concept of transition state versus intermediate. Remember that the middle step of a SN2 was to make a transition state. Well, in this case, for an SN1, your middle step is an intermediate. What does that mean? You actually can isolate this. This is a molecule that it's not very stable, but it actually can be isolated and I can make some of it. I could make carbocations and I could keep them in a test tube and I could keep them for a little bit, all right? So now I have my carbocation intermediate. What's the next step gonna be? Is it just gonna end there? Obviously not, okay? The next step is gonna be that now I have my weak nucleophile that was just chilling, but now I have a very strong electrophile. A carbocation is one of the strongest electrophiles possible. So when my nucleophile sees that, you know what? It might not be negative, but it has electrons. So then it's going to go ahead and attack the carbocation. So in the second step, my nucleophile comes and attacks. But now I have a question for you guys. Do I have a front side and a back side that I have to worry about? No, because it turns out I don't have a halogen attached anymore. Remember before, I always had my halogen attached, so I could only go from the back. But now, all I have is this planar structure that I could either attack from the front or from the back equally. It doesn't matter which one. So that means that I have two different ways that I could attack. I could either attack from the back or I could attack from the front. And that could lead, if I have a chiral center, that could lead to two different products, okay? So what that means is that, by the way, is this chiral? Yeah, it is. It's the same compound as before. So what that means is that I could get the example where my nucleophile is here, but everything's exactly the same. Okay, so what that means is that the chirality doesn't change at all. That's if it, let's say, attacked from the front, okay? Because it's just, basically it's attacking from the same side that the X attacked from, or that the X left from. So basically the X was here, my nucleophile attacks from the front, so it attaches to the same place, all right? But the other product that it could give me is the back product. So what it could also do is it could attack from the back side, which means that the nucleophile would be attached to where the ethyl group used to be. And what that means is that I would get the other chiral center, okay? Is there a way to determine exactly which one I'm gonna get? No, it turns out that because this is trigonal planar, it's actually a 50-50 shot. I have 50% chance that I'm going to collide into the front. Remember, this is just based on collisions. I also have a 50% chance that I'm going to collide into the back. So what that means is that I know that I'm going to have more than one enantiomer possible if it is a chiral center. We're going to hold that thought, and I'm going to keep explaining more things about this reaction, but I just want you guys to see how that is right now, okay? Is there anything else that I should draw? Yeah, remember that there's going to be the X, and the X is going to have a negative sign, okay? So notice that my product came out similar to the SN2. I'm going to get substitution at the end. The only difference is that I have some differences with the arrows. First of all, the arrows are completely different, and my stereochemistry seems a little bit off. So we're going to go ahead and talk about that in a little bit. All right?